everybody. This is Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com. And today I'm doing cooked peach jam. Yep, it's peach season. And yesterday I did frozen peach jam, which was very quick and easy, but you need freezer space. If you don't have freezer space, then you want to do the cooked, because that can just stay on the shelf and not have to be frozen. So the process is very similar. It has similar ingredients. You're going to have peaches. You're going to have sugar. Yes, this is one batch of sugar. That's 5.5 cups of sugar. Sugar is the main ingredient in jams and jellies. It's what preserves them, because it makes them sweet and it just preserves them. You're going to need sugar gel or a fruit pectin. Sugar gel is the one my mom used, so that's the one I'm using. And this helps to set the jam so that it's not just a runny, juicy liquid. It actually has body to it and sticks together. And then the other ingredient is lemon juice, fresh lemon juice. As always, you're going to start with the fruit. So you're going to take the fruit. Now, we bought some fruit last weekend. It wasn't quite ready, which was fine. So I took each individual piece. I wrapped it into a little piece of newspaper, and they've been sitting downstairs now for a week. They're ready. They're not overly ripe. They're just perfect. They can probably go for several more days, and I'm going to be making some peach cobbler and probably several batches of the cooked peach jam.
Oh, goody, 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 goody.
And you'll have to have a taste of it, just like yesterday, to see if it's up to your standards, Mr. Cameraman.
I'm sure it will be.
I'm going to take boiling hot water, and I'm pouring it over my peaches. This is how you take the skins off. It's the same process you use for tomatoes when you're canning tomatoes.
Now, fogging up my lens.
Of course, they don't quite all fit here. I'm setting my timer for 1 minute. That's as long as it takes for the skin to get loose so you can just peel it off. Now, these ones that are sticking out a little bit, I'm just going to turn them so that everybody gets a chance to be under the hot water. And you'll see, by the time the minute is up, the skin is already starting to peel off. You want to look, see how that goes? I mean, I barely touched it and it's already coming off. The colors are just magnificent.
Well, I said eating that jam you made yesterday was like eating a slice of love. It was absolutely delicious. Mm.
And sunshine. I mean,
and sunshine, yes.
And sunshine.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So even our daughter was blessed by taking some peaches home with her. She's going to make cobbler also. There you go. Okay. Now you want to cool them off quickly, because you don't want to cook them right now. This is just the skin part. So I'm dumping out the half, and I'm going to put cold in here to cool them off. See how the skin is already coming off? Well, it's just a matter of peeling it back. It's almost easier just to use your fingers. And you'll notice that in some places it sticks, and sometimes that means that there might be a little bruise there, and other times it just means it's being stubborn. If you see bruises or things that are not perfect, just take a little slice out of there. And I wanted to make sure when you're doing this that you take out the skin that's way down inside here. You don't want that in your jam. Sometimes it's just easier to do it when you're cutting them in half. Now, these are called freestone peaches as opposed to cling peaches. No difference in flavor. These are Red Haven. peaches. Free stone means that they're not going to stick to the stone, as in cling. Okay, how easily that comes off. And there you can see there's little bits of the seed or the stem there. I like to take that out. And then you just go in and you pull the rest of it out. Take that little bit out. And once I have them all peeled, then I'll put them in a bowl and I'm going to be chopping them finely. And finely means, what size piece do you want on your toast or your muffin in the morning when you're eating your jams? You want a big chunk? Do you want small pieces? Probably not a good idea to puree it, but I mean, if that's your bag, if you like it all mushed together so you don't see any, you can do that if that's what you like. Just remember, the bigger the chunk, you're going to have the tartness of the fruit compared to the sweetness of the gel itself. So I have some peeling to do.
Yes, you do.
Last peach about to go in. This is the damage I was talking about. This looks like a little critter was trying to chew there, so I'm just going to take that out.
I did not do that to the peach.
Are you sure about that?
Positive.
Okay, now, they want it chopped finely. So if you have a chopper like this slap chop that I have, that works great. If you don't have one, just cut it very fine with your knife, or cut it fine and then use a regular old potato masher to mash it down some.
Well, so far this is exactly like
the frozen
version.
Yes, but it's about to change.
Ooh.
All right, that part's done. Now I'm going to, where's my chopper? I'm going to start chopping. It goes faster if you have a chopper. It's fun. It's important to remember you have to measure. And it's very important to measure carefully, because unlike with spaghetti or meatloaf, you can kind of improvise and add this ingredient and that and your special ingredient. With jellies and jams, it's a chemical process that needs to be followed just very
carefully.
Directly. Yes. So I need 4 cups. That's 2 cups. And if you watched my video about the frozen jam, you noticed that I had a very small pan because it wasn't going to be cooking at all. But with the cooked jam, it cooks and it gets bigger, so I have a larger pan. Okay, so there's my 4 cups, and that was 10 peaches, just to give you an idea. And I need 2 tablespoons of lemon juice. That's the same. Lemon juice keeps it nice and yellow. Without that, your fruit starts to oxidize and you're going to have brown peach jam. Never a good thing. Okay, and then the other thing that I need is the sure gel, which is just a white powdery liquid.
So now that's one package of sure gel for the 4, mm-hmm. where yesterday you used one packet for only 3 cups.
Correct. And one more difference is 1 teaspoon of butter. Now you're thinking, why in the world would I put butter in? Supposedly this keeps the foam from forming. Now that comes when you add the sugar. So some people like the foam. We always used to love it as kids because my mom would skim it off and not wanting to put that in the jam, and then we'd get to eat it. I'm going to mix this all up and then I'm going to cook it. And it has to cook until it boils, and it has to boil until you cannot stir it down. That means no matter how fast or hard you're stirring, it's still boiling. And that is the point where you start timing. The next step is to start cooking it, since it is cooked jam. So in here, now just to rehash, we've got the peaches, the lemon juice, the sugar gel, and 1 teaspoon of butter. And I'm going to bring this to a rolling boil. That means it's a boil that will not go away when I'm stirring it. At that point, when it's at the boiling, rolling boil stage, that's when all the sugar goes in all at once. And then when it starts boiling again, you time it for 1 minute. That's the only tricky part about this. You have to catch it no more than 1 minute.
So, will it caramelize?
Possibly that's what happens, or maybe too much of the liquid evaporates or something, but you don't want to do that. So this will take a while because the peaches are room temperature. And I just want to stir it every now and again just so it doesn't stick.
Sure looks pretty.
Doesn't it? Now you see that I have my steamer out. You can use a canner, pan, or a steamer. Mine's a steamer. That means that instead of setting my jars into a bath of hot water, they will sit on top of this rack and the steam is what's going to cook them. And they have to, after we put them in the jars, they have to go in here and steam for several minutes before you can take them out. About 10 minutes has passed. It smells wonderful in here. And you'll see that it's boiling, and even though I'm stirring, it continues to boil. That's what it means by not stirring it down. Now I'm going to add all the sugar at once. You're going to see this change from this creamy kind of base to a clear base, kind of like making gravy and using flour where it makes it creamy and cornstarch where it makes it clear. 5 1/2 cups of sugar.
Ouch.
That's why you don't eat a whole lot of this. Now they do have recipes that use artificial coloring, sugar, or fruit juices that are sweeter. All right, now see how it's turning clear already? You can see the actual pieces of peach as opposed to just all being the same color. Now this is going to take a couple minutes because the sugar, obviously, was room temperature. And it'll take a little bit until again it's at a rolling boil that you can't stir down. Then I start timing for 1 minute. And then that's when it usually would get a little foam on the top, little suds. But ours is not supposed to. We'll see. Again, it was almost 10 minutes, not quite. This is a boil that I cannot stir down. I'm starting my timer for 1 minute. All this while it's cooking, you need to be stirring it. After all your work, you don't want to scorch it and have burnt peach jam. That would not be a good thing.
So how long do you stir? Now?
1 minute.
Oh, 1 minute.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So 1 minute. And you can see there's sort of a little bit of bubbly foam on the top, but not near as much as would have been without the butter, I'm guessing. 1 minute is done. Stop immediately. And this is when you move it off of the heat and put it over next to where you're going to be putting it in the jars. Again, so you don't scorch it in any way. All right, now I have my jars ready. I washed them thoroughly. I put boiling water into them, and now they're as clean as they're going to get. And I'm going to try to use all the same size jars so that they, when I cook them, they will be done all at the same time.
I'm going to move over on this side.
Okay. I feel like I'm doing a square dance here. Smells wonderful. Now, yesterday when I did frozen jam, I needed to leave 1/2 inch of expanding space. With this one, you need to leave 1/4 inch because this isn't going to expand anymore. Okay? So.
It's absolutely beautiful.
Mm-hmm. All right, so all the same size. And you want to make sure that you're getting juice and peaches, not just juice or not just peaches. Make sure you get a nice mixture.
Well, when the snow flies, this will be a true delight.
Speaking of snow flying, this would be a wonderful thing to do in the middle of winter instead of the end of summer when it's warm. This kitchen is warm. When I'm doing my raspberry jam in the middle of winter, I'm going to be pleased because I froze my raspberries. And I'm guessing you could freeze the peaches. I just don't know if you'd have to do something to them to keep them from oxidizing. So I know I'm safe with my raspberries.
Well, somehow we'll suffer and do it during the summertime. That way we won't be suffering when the snow flies as much.
Okay, that's about it. I don't have enough to make another jar full. So what's gonna happen is we'll pour the rest into a pan, and gee, I wonder if anything will happen to it while I'm not looking. Oh, you know, well, no, I don't want to do it.
Could have done a tiny one.
I could have. I just wouldn't cook it at the same time. Let me see if I can get it in. You're right. Less for you to nibble.
Why did I ever suggest that?
Yes, why did you? I'm making sure that there's no jam on the top of the jar, and also a second inspection to make sure there are no chips out of the jars. They are hot, so be careful. Then what I'm going to do is, these are the tops, these are the lids, they're called lids. I have them sitting here in very warm water just to soften up that rubber gasket there. Then I'm going to put that on there, and then I put the ring on.
Are you engaged?
I'm engaged in jam making. And I'm going to turn it so that it's just tight but not overly tight. You don't want to crank it down really hard, and you don't want it to be loose. You just have the Goldilocks thing right in the middle. Okay, then clean off the rim. Make sure there's no chips or any jam up there that would interfere, because these are going to seal now. And these will sit on the shelf. They're not going to be in a refrigerator. They're going to be on the shelf.
Well, they have to be cooked, right?
Well, yes, but yes, eventually, till you open them, they're going to sit there all by their little lonesome self, waiting for you to eat.
Can I start now?
You can try that little bit that's left in the bowl.
Well, I think I should taste test it.
Well, you probably should.
You know, we might have to throw all of this away if it's not good.
Somehow I don't think so. All right, let me show you where these are going right away. Got my steamer heating up. I only have about 1.5 inches of water in there. That's all I need for my steamer canner. And then these will sit on the rack. I'll get it going, and out of this hole, steam will start shooting out. And when the steam gets to be about 8 inches, that's when I start timing. And since these are small jars, they only have to steam for 5 minutes, which is nice. Thank you. little bit of space. Turn up the heat.
So you're not going to cook the little one?
No, because it's a different size. And I don't think that one needs to go quite as long. So.
Okay.
He has to wait for another turn. Okay, so when this comes out, this will take a while. Not too long, though, because what I'm cooking is already hot. And the water in the bottom of the pan is already hot, so it's not going to take as long as, let's say, a quart of tomatoes, which would take 10-15 minutes before I even saw the steam, and then it's like 25 to 35 minutes for a quart of tomatoes. So this should go quite quickly. Okay, let's see how these look. Very carefully, I'm going to lift them out and to keep them horizontal. And they should start popping any minute now. And that tells me they're sealed. There we go. All right, so we have 6 pints and 7 half pints, and then, or are these pints? These are pints, excuse me. 2 pints, these are half pints, and these are quarter pints. This one, unfortunately, didn't have enough, but fortunately, we're going to be eating that one.
Aww, isn't that special?
Yes, it is. So, that's my afternoon's work. That would be, how many pounds of... Well, 20, it's 20 peaches, because there was 10 in each batch, and I came out with this much jam. So, it's a good afternoon's work.
And how many more peaches do you still have left?
Many. 2.5 boxes.
Oh, 2.5 boxes, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a lot of peach cobbler. I hope you're ready. If you enjoyed this, please give us a thumbs up. And if you'd like to leave a comment and tell us what you're doing right now, we'd love to hear from you. And also, we'd love to have you join our garden family and subscribe. Now, I remember my mom putting paraffin on the top of her jam. She didn't put hers in a canner. She just put paraffin. So if any of you out there are still using paraffin instead of putting them in a steamer or canner, please let me know, and let me know how your results are coming out.
And I should mention, we did do a taste test.
Yes, we did.
Oh my goodness.
Mm-mm. And which did you prefer, the frozen or the cooked?
Well, I actually prefer the cooked. It was definitely, I don't want to say creamier. Oop. I heard a pop.
There's another one, that's two.
But it had a richness to it that... While the other one was very good, don't get me wrong, I mean, this one even surpassed it.
It's a deeper flavor, yeah. I think, too.
But like you said, I think the other one will have a fresher taste.
Yes, and a different texture,
yes,
the frozen.
Right.
Yes.
But, good. Well, I know what I'm going to have on my ice cream tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Say goodbye.
Connect with us on YouTube.